Hello friends, welcome to Akul Mac Live. My name is Chandrakant. Today in Legal Matters, we want to discuss about the rental agreement. As you know friends, people actually shift from one city to other, and the easiest method to live in the other place, new address, is to find an apartment and take it on rent. The owners actually produce the rental agreements, sometimes on a 20 rupees stamp paper, sometimes on a 100 rupees stamp paper, sometimes even on plain paper. And the tenant also sign on these options. Is there a police verification required? Is there a background check required? What are the terms and conditions for a rental agreement? All these we will discuss today in our program. But before that, a word on our giveaway. Akul Mac works with many SMEs and startups world over, helping them in not only building their sales and marketing teams, but also help them in improving their success rate. As you can see, we have summarized our years of knowledge into these easy to follow steps, which can be used by any smart leader to promote their group or a company. In order to encourage people to take the right step at the right time, we have used this proprietary graph in our corporate memorabilia, so that the knowledge can be accessed by whoever, whenever, wherever it is needed. You can become eligible to get one of these beautiful gifts delivered to your doorstep for free. All you need to do is to subscribe our channel and smash that like button. Also, please watch this entire video and provide your valuable comments, suggestions, or you could also share your experiences. Person with the best comment and interaction would be chosen to become a free recipient of one of these displayed items here. In addition, we would invite you to Akul Mac Live to participate in our show as a distinguished panelist. What are you waiting for, friends? Go for it. Now, let's get back to our discussion. Hello, friends. Let me introduce our guest today. He's joining us from Ahmedabad. His name is Jeet Bhatt, practicing advocate in Ahmedabad High Court. So without further ado, let me present Jeet to you.
Thank you, Chandrakant, for having me on this show. I'm looking forward for today's discussion on this interesting topic.
Yes, Jeet, actually what we want to discuss is about the rental agreements. While people actually get into different types of rental agreements in different cities, but they don't have the thorough knowledge of what can happen from the legal standpoint. So I think we would like to understand the rental agreement and the laws around it today.
Yes, certainly, Chandrakant. It's a very important segment in today's property rights. And as we see a lot of migration happening, where a lot of people from different cities are traveling and migrating to different other big cities, metro cities. So the first thing that they look out for is a place to stay. And therefore, it becomes important initially till the time that they are able to purchase their own properties. They would want to live in a rented apartment or a rented place. So basically, in order to get a rented place, the first thing that you have to look out for is a rent agreement, because after finding out the place where you want to stay, the most important legal document that is created is the rental agreement. So a rental agreement is basically a legal document stating the terms and conditions which the owner and the tenant agree, and it is executed, signed by the owner and the tenant, and also in presence of two witnesses. But there are a lot of legal issues and legal questions which come up, and also what are the best terms and conditions that should be mentioned, and what is the liabilities and what are the restrictions of the owner as well as the tenant must be clearly stated in the rental agreement. Because what happens is, most of the time these rental agreements are not vetted, or no legal opinion is taken before executing, and therefore sometimes it has clauses which favor the tenant, or sometimes it has clauses which mostly favor the owner. So it is important that a proper document is prepared, which is balanced document, which gives rights and obligations and duties to both the tenant as well as the owner, so that there are no legal disputes which arise. So basically, It has to be prepared and vetted through a legal person. And what a rent agreement should include is that the terms and conditions, which are most important. First of all, the tenant is entitled to see the documents from the owner, that he is the actual owner. Because a lot of times the properties are also managed by the property manager. So the tenants are entitled and must check the legal documents of the property which they are going to use as a tenant. So that is very important, and they can claim and they can ask, and they are entitled to check the title records. And once they are satisfied that the owner is the person whom they are entering into this agreement, because even if there are property managers who manage the property, but it should be, ideally, it should be the owner who must execute the rent agreement, or the owner should have given the power of attorney to the property managers to execute a rent agreement. And then only the tenant must enter and execute a rent agreement. And this is very important, because otherwise what happens is there might be legal complications. The owner might say that I've never authorized, and this document is not valid because I am the owner of the property. So the tenant is entitled, and he must check first the title documents and the ownership of the owner with whom he's going to enter into the rent agreement. So the second aspect is the terms and condition, where the amount of rent and the tenure for the rent should be clearly specified. Also, with regards to the tenure, if the tenure is more than 12 months, then under the Registration Act, the agreement becomes compulsorily registrable. So then the document has to be registered in order to have a legal validity to the document. Because otherwise, if it is not registered, and if the document has to be compulsorily registered, and if there is any dispute which leads to a litigation in court, the rent agreement would become inadmissible in evidence because it is not registered. So therefore, the document which has to be registered compulsorily under the Registration Act has to be registered. Otherwise, it will have no validity in the eye of law. And therefore, if there is a lease deed or a rent agreement which is more than for a period of more than 12 months, it has to be registered. If it is less than, say, 12 months, and what we see in most of the cities and popularly what is known as leave and license, is an 11-month agreement. And it is an 11-month agreement because it is not required to be registered. And therefore, in order to save the registration fees and the hassle of registering a document for the sub-registrar, normally, and also it has become a commercial practice that it is better to have a 11-month, so that legal issues do not arise. So the tenant as well as the owners execute an 11-month rent agreement. Well, 11-month rent agreement, there is no difficulty. But now the Model Tenancy Code has been laid down by the central government, asking every state to enact the tenancy code, a new tenancy code. Because time has come that the old tenancy acts must be replaced, and they've outlived their time, because those were enacted in 40s, 50s, 60s. They are 50, 60 year old, and were of a different era altogether. At that time, the tenants were heavily protected, and rightly so, because the time was such after the Second World War and the problems that the tenant faced. But now it's a completely different scenario. The tenants require some protection, but the owners also are required equal protection under the law, which was not available to the owners under the old tenancy laws. So therefore, the central government has come out with the Model Tenancy Code of 2019, which specifies a lot of things for the states to enact. And if I may just give you the idea of the tenancy code of 2019, which the states had to give their inputs by October 2020, and it was to be enacted in 2020 or early 2021, but since the present situation, it has not been enacted. But all states have to enact this tenancy code. It provides for the tenancy agreement, tenancy period, rights and duties of successor in the case of death, also provides for restrictions on subletting, Then it has provisions for revision of rent. It also has a rent authority which will be appointed by the state government, who will not be below the rank of a deputy collector. It prescribes the obligations of landowner and tenant, also has provisions for repossession of the premise by the landowner and the appointment of rent authorities. And it also prescribes rent courts and rent tribunals, where the disputes will be adjudicated in a fast track mode. And the rent courts will have to decide, the rent court will be an authority not below the ranking of deputy collector, who will initially decide the dispute within a period of 60 days, and thereafter an appeal is provided. And the appeal also goes to the rent court, which has to decide the appeal within a period of 60 days. So it is a very fast track provision made under the tenancy code in order to see that the disputes arising out of the rent agreements are settled in a fast track mode. And this is very much important and required, because at present the rent disputes go on for years and years. To get a tenant vacated, he sometimes becomes a headache for the owner, and he continues to occupy despite the agreements being over several years ago. So therefore, such protection to the tenants and a one-sided tenant protection act is no longer required in the present scenario. And therefore, this tenancy code should be adopted. But once it will be adopted and enacted, I'm sure it will definitely increase this entire market of rents in India, which is highly essential and required at the present moment. Since my property market, the property prices being so high, most migrants or most people going to different cities prefer to stay on rent rather than purchasing properties. So other things that are required in a rent agreement is what I said is rent tenure, rent amount, and also the date on which the amount becomes due and payable. So either it can be the first week or first 10 days. Also penal payment if rent is not paid in the due date, or if it is paid late. Also some facilities for the tenant should also be provided in the rent agreement. Also the rent escalation clause should be there, and this should be discussed with the tenant and the owner, because what happens is that sometimes if the rent prices in the area rises or shoots, the owner sometimes gives a notice saying that now the rent price is increased from say 7,000 to 10,000, and the tenant has no other option but to pay. So in such situations, there should be a rent escalation clause which should provide for a advance period of say 2 months or 3 months, which gives some rescue to the tenant, as well as if there is a rent escalation within that period, then he gets some time in order to ensure that whether he wants to continue to occupy the premise or he wants to vacate it. Also, there should be clauses or provisions for prohibition of subletting, or if the owner wants, then subletting can also be permitted, but there has to be clear provisions for that. And also there should be provisions for renewal terms after the contract expires, you know, in case if the tenant wants to continue. And also the rent escalation should be provided. So these should be the clauses or terms which should be there in the rent agreement. With respect to any other terms, there can be a term on or a clause on the sale of the house, because if the landlord decides to sell the house during the term of the rent agreement, then at least the tenant should be aware as to how many months he will get to find a new accommodation, because there has to be an advance notice before any action is to be taken either by the tenant or by the owner. Sometimes there are also lock-in period clauses in the agreement, which entitles the owner to forfeit the security deposit if the tenant wants to withdraw or cancel the rent agreement or vacate the place before that lock-in period. So therefore, the agreement should provide all these clauses and which should be agreed by both the sides, and then only it has to be executed. So without proper understanding, it might create a lot of difficulties to both the owner as well as the tenant. And also now there is a police verification which is required, and which is also very much essential. Also, there are clauses which in the rent agreement which says that illegal activities cannot be undertaken. And if undertaken, then the rent agreement would be cancelled or could be declared as void. And the tenant would be at once have to vacate the premises. And these are necessary because what happens if some illegal activities are done and if they are caught, then the police authorities would seize the entire apartment. And then the owner also would not be able to use the premises for a certain period of time till the investigation is complete. So therefore, these all clauses become very important and should be included in the rent agreement. Yes, so it can't be on a plain paper because it's a rent agreement. It has to be stamped. The necessary stamps amount differ from state to state. But if it has to be registered, then some states have a requirement of registration fees of around, say, 2%. If I'm not wrong, in Delhi, it is around 2% of the amount. And in different states, there are different provisions for the amount of registration fees which is charged. But it has to be on a stamp paper and it can't be on a plain paper. So therefore, depending on what is the amount that every state prescribes, the said amount has to be fixed on the stamp paper.
With regard to the GST, because now we are having an issue where the GST is also being charged for various items. So is there a possibility of charging GST by the owner?
Well, with respect to GST, in terms of rents, GST amount, I don't think that the owner, because it will be an income and it is entitled to deductions under ATDD. But with respect to GST, I am not sure whether GST can be charged because it is not a goods or a service which is provided.
All right, Jeet. So basically, you know, any rental income gets added to the income of the owner, basically, and then the income tax is charged on that. So that is a set practice. But with the GST, I think the confusion that still prevails that whether when we are providing service, because I think it's a top of a type of a service where the owner is subletting his property or providing his property entirely on rent. How it is treated, because even in the commercial sector where the companies actually lease their properties out to other companies like business centers and all, there is a GST component there. So I think that is something that we need to clarify to our viewers also.
Well, if there is a property manager or if a property management which provides for certain services, if they take and if they charge for that, then certainly those services would be governed under the GST regime.
Fine. Jeet, I think there is another issue which is also emerging, which is not legal in nature, but I think we can inform our viewers about it, that the World Commercial Organization and Indian government has teamed up together and they have tried to standardize the various aspects of doing business, and the tenancy law is also falling under that. But we are not discussing this today. This is just information that there is a particular code which has to be applied while raising an invoice to, from the owner to the tenant. And that has to be registered with the finance authority or, you know, whichever, because, you know, when CA is actually doing your taxation, there will be some changes to the this whole process of collecting the rent for your property. So we are not discussing this. Jeet, I think you summarized the whole thing very nicely. You also mentioned that the type of stamp paper we need. And you have also very clearly defined that what are the terms and conditions that the owner must keep in mind while signing up a tenant and also police verification. So thank you so much for coming to our show and explaining this things to our viewers.
Thank you very much, Chandrakant, for having me.
So we will catch you again in the legal matters in the next episode. on the next Sunday. Until then, I like to say goodbye.
Goodbye. Thank you.